Our world is constantly evolving. As time moves forward, things change, which is why it's important to stay informed. Throughout the year, there are dozens of professionals that share their expertise with the community through lectures sponsored by local government agencies and area not-for-profits. And each month, we'll feature one of these visiting professors as they discuss the latest current events and trends. So grab a notebook and pull up a chair because the lecture hall is about to begin.
Yeah, I'm all right. You can all hear and everything. Good. Thank you very much for that introduction, and it's a whole lot more than you needed to hear about me. But I'm really glad to be here, and I love FAU. My daughter goes to school here, and we're happy to be here with you tonight. I was thinking about this talk this morning when I was interviewed on a radio show, and the theme of the radio show was what boomers are doing with their lives these days. And I guess I am a boomer. I was born in 1946. And about the same age as Bill Clinton and George Bush and some other folks. And I started talking a little bit about my own life and what I do. And I started thinking about these boomers and what we are faced with today. You know, we thought back in the 70s that we were going to fix this environmental problem. We thought we were going to do that because, you know, we were pretty smart and we were young, we were aggressive. By golly, we could do it. A few things happened. But on the way to becoming aging boomers, they all of a sudden it seems like there's a whole lot more needs to be done. We're not finished yet. In fact, it seems like we hardly even started. So I think one of the interesting things about being a boomer is we're going to have the opportunity to try to do it again. At least I'm trying to do it again. And I didn't have much power back then. I don't have a whole lot of power now, but at least I can write about it. I have a certain perspective and a point of view, but I don't think I'm any more of an environmentalist today than I was in 1973. It's an interesting thought. It's also the case, I think, that boomers will not cede power to this young generation the way our fathers and mothers did. Looks like we're going to hang around a little longer. We're still working, still running for president, some of us. We're still out there trying to hold on to the reins of power. I guess because, in part, we failed to fix it the first time, so we want another chance to do it. That's probably what this whole election is really about, is which person's going to be allowed the chance to fix it. But let's hope it does get fixed, because the environment is a huge issue. Newt and I believe that this is the environmental century, that a lot will be done, certainly a lot can be done, and we'll be in deep trouble if a lot isn't done. Now, I have had some unique opportunities in my career, and I want to give some credit to my mother for all this, because my mother loved animals. And she had the opportunity when she was a young woman to do a little modeling in San Diego, where I grew up. And she did a little modeling for the San Diego Zoo. I got to believe this somehow is in my genes. And these are the first dingoes, by the way, that were brought to the San Diego Zoo in 1939. And I always have fun showing that picture. What we zoo directors are able to do is to contribute in meaningful ways to conservation in all the ways that conservation can be done. I've had a long career studying and attempting to understand the great apes in the wild and in captivity. And one of the greatest things about the Zoo Atlanta facility that we built there is that it has continuously produced baby gorillas since the first moments that the exhibit opened in 1988. Now 23 gorillas born there. It's one of the most successful gorilla propagation efforts of any zoo. But it's also a zoo that is very fundamentally involved in conservation. Now, the AZA, which is the governing body of American zoos and aquariums, is committed to conservation. And this is part of their mission statement. And you can see that our job is to inspire, to educate, and motivate. And virtually every zoo in America that's accredited by AZA has this mission. And we're all doing it in various ways. Palm Beach Zoo, is fully committed to conservation, education, science, humane animal care, doing it right. Now, I've had some experience writing about these things. My book, Zoo Man, was a look inside what I called, at the time I wrote the book, the zoo revolution. And I truly believe that we are still engaged in a revolution to try to get our zoological parks and aquariums, frankly, to reach the high standards that the public has set for us. And we're not trying to let tigers out, kill people, do some of the things you've been reading about lately. It could happen to just about anybody, but it's certainly going to happen if you don't understand what the barriers ought to be. We have an accreditation process for zoos that should prevent these kinds of things from happening. But it's not a perfect science or a perfect art. But we have to build our zoological parks to very high standards. And that's why our communities have to get behind us and help us to achieve those standards. It's going to take a lot of money, a lot of commitment. But more importantly, it takes really good ideas, really good people and good programs working within a strong community to make a great zoo great. I have to tell you, too, I'm a little bit of philosophy here. I always tell my staff this, you know, the zoo in Palm Beach is only 22 acres. But you don't have to be big to be great. You only have to be great. And that means you have to have big ideas, top people, top programs. You have to be smart. That's how you get to be great. Later on, I had a chance to write about giant pandas, and it was a great thrill because I spent 10 years trying to bring pandas to Zoo Atlanta. I had to work with the federal government in China as well as the USA. And if you read this book, you'll discover that it's my opinion anyway, that the bureaucracy in the USA is worse than the bureaucracy in China. It was easy getting the Chinese to agree to send the pandas here. It was very difficult to get the United States government to agree to it. Now, along the way to building Zoo Atlanta, which was a great thrill, a great privilege, and a great honor, a local politician came to visit me. And I didn't know much about him. His name was Newt Gingrich. But here's something he told me in about 1985. He said, I'm going to be Speaker of the House someday. And I thought, you know, what's he talking about? That's never going to happen, you know. But by golly, he did it. I didn't become his friend because he was going to become Speaker of the House. I became his friend because he loved animals like no politician I have ever seen. I couldn't believe how committed he was to wildlife and to the zoo, and he loved the idea, being a conservative, that this was no longer a city zoo, but it was a privatized nonprofit zoo, an example of public-private partnership, which he advocates even today. Zoo Atlanta became his favorite story about the privatization of a city facility that did not do well under local government, but became really, really good with the energy and the commitment of the private sector. So, in that he had to come visit me from time to time to see how this institution was doing, we became friends and spent many years talking about different issues, including the Endangered Species Act, which is where our friendship really began to power up. Now, I should tell you that Newt was, in those days, a benefactor of mine. He told me almost from the first day that he wanted to help me buy animals, and he very quietly sent me checks. And these were the Komodo dragons that he arranged to bring to the zoo. He flew them down in a private jet from the National Zoo, and we picked them up there, and they're now huge creatures. But that was a really fun thing to do with Newt. And so he was already a benefactor, and when I needed a rhino, I called him up and said, Newt, I need a rhino, but I'm going to need a lot more money than it costs for the Komodos. But I said, here's the good part. These rhinos are behind the Iron Curtain, and we're going to liberate them from Marxism. He liked that. So he gave me $9,000, which is what it takes to move a rhino from Czechoslovakia to the USA. But he said, there's one thing, though. I want you to name it after my friend. He had a friend named Bo. So I found a Swahili word, Boma, which means fortress, and we call it Bo. The rhino is still there. So this was a great gift to us and an example of his dedication. So as we moved on, we got into more serious issues. Now, to give you an idea of how E.O. Wilson, a lot of people ask me, and by the way, I feel like I need to talk about this not so much as just the issues involved in the book, but how the book was put together, because I guess I'm now an environmental writer, and there is a certain process that you go through to do a book like this. One of the things you have to do if you're working with a prominent conservative who is not readily recognized as an environmental person is you have to establish your credentials. And we've gone through in the book some of Newt's history on the environment. And one of the things that happened is Newt saved the Endangered Species Act. The Republican Party at that time was zeroing out a lot of things in their zeal to reduce the size of government. And some of the things that were picked out, some of us had trouble with. And one of them, we zoo people thought should not be zeroed out, was the Endangered Species Act. But we brought people like Ed Wilson to see Newt. Now, Ed Wilson is by many regarded as the world's leading biologist. He's an expert on biodiversity, a wonderful man. He spent most of his career studying ants. Now, not only did Ed Wilson influence Newt's thinking, he spent a lot of time with him working through this thing. But he came to visit me at Zoo Atlanta when the endowed chair was being set up for me at Georgia Tech. And he spoke to the entire college, a very eminent man speaking about this chair. When he came to the zoo, I introduced him to this Tamandua anteater. And they became fast friends. In fact, on his next book, on the back of his book, he put the picture we took of him and our Tamandua on the back cover of his book. An anteater! And he's an ant man! So I thought this remarkable. I said to Ed, I said, geez, I can't believe you'd like an anteater after all the time you spent with ants. And he told me something very revealing. He said, Terry, that's the great thing about ants. There's lots of them. So we named the anteater Wilson. But I have to tell you that part of the reason I think that we were able to deal with the Endangered Species Act with some credibility is that all of us that were working on this, scientists and zoo people and administrators of conservation organizations, working with Newt, trying to get this thing protected the best way we could, we had all been there on the front lines of conservation. And one of the things I experienced in one of my many trips to Africa was a poaching field. And I have to tell you that this is without a doubt the most disturbing thing that I've ever witnessed. And that is three elephants slaughtered. And I was there just a day after it happened. And it was the most tragic thing to see it. Two adults and a baby elephant. And just to get their ivory. So I've been around this ivory problem for a long time, trying to help African conservation groups to protect elephants. Another interesting aspect of this was a media ad that was put together by the African Wildlife Foundation in the 90s. And the ad depicted elephants being shot. So it did not pass the censors. But the people that put the ad together, Saatchi & Saatchi, a very eminent ad firm, wanted people to be shocked by this. And they wanted them to know that when you bought ivory, you were buying it from dead elephants. They showed the shooting, and they put a script on there that said only elephants should wear ivory. It was a shocking piece of video. And AWF came to me and asked me if I would go to Ted Turner. Because Ted Turner had the toughest standards in the media. So I went to Ted, He gave it to his people. They looked at it, and the people said, no, this does not pass our standard. We don't allow video that shows the hurting of animals. So they sent it up to Ted himself. And Ted made the really incredible decision to let it be viewed on his television network. Soon as Ted Turner said okay, the other network said okay. And there was a run, most of it on late night television, of these very vivid commercials. And I believe it had a lot to do with putting the elephants firmly on the endangered species list during a period when they needed a lot of visibility. Now, I'm happy to say that I'm in Palm Beach, Florida at this time, helping Newt once again to influence conservation. I've just approved a letter that he asked me to approve that he is sending to President Bush. He sent a letter to President Bush to encourage him, and I wrote about it in the book, to support these Northwest Hawaiian Islands for protection. This is the largest expanse of protection that's ever been approved by the U.S. government. It's a marine system. And now it looks like the president has an opportunity at the end of his term to make another investment in protection. And Newt is asking that the more disparate pieces, they're not all connected the way the Hawaiian piece was, but there are two of them that are not far from us. This protection would extend to the deep coral reefs off Florida. And this protection would extend to Navassa Island, which is an island that has diversity akin to the Galapagos. It's an uninhabited island somewhere around Cuba. It hasn't been looked at much. But I'm really excited that Newt will write this letter. I think the president will accept his recommendation, and I believe you're going to see another big story about conservation coming down the road. Watch for it. So there are lots of things that we can do if we get out there and try. The zoo director in any community has an opportunity at a bully pulpit. If we don't take that opportunity to preach conservation, to inspire, to educate, to motivate, then we're not doing our job. There's a lot more to it than just opening the gates and letting people come visit. I know that y'all love the Palm Beach Zoo. I hear it all the time. It's a lovely zoo. But a zoo has to be important, not just to visitors, but to the world, because we have an opportunity to utilize the icons within, the gorillas, the elephants, the jaguars, the panthers, the birds, all the creatures. Yes, Emily, even the herps, even the reptiles. My daughter's a reptile keeper. Even they're important. And it's our job to keep them out there in front of the public as icons of conservation, as ambassadors for their own kind living in the world. It's so important that we be conservationists. Now, along the way to writing a book with Newt Gingrich, I had to deal with people's caricatures of Newt Gingrich. And there's a lot of people who think that the contract with America was detrimental to the environment. If you read it point by point, there's nothing in there that says we will be detrimental to the environment, but it has something to do with whether or not you support particular programs that are supported by federal funds. And in that feeding frenzy of the contract, there was a lot of debate about what was right or wrong with it. But I purposely chose, and I chose the title, Contract with the Earth, because I wanted people to think about why a contract with the Earth was equally as important, if not more important, than a contract with America. But I had to think a little bit about what a contract would really mean. And Newt is committed to the environment, but he is committed in a way that is influenced by his values, his conservative values. So the first question was, could a conservative be a conservationist? And I know lots of conservative conservationists, including Newton. I can tell you that is absolutely true, that they can be, and they are. So we coined a new phrase. We call it mainstream environmentalism. And what we want it to be, which is why I chose the term inclusive environmentalism, is a big tent. Because right now, with so much gridlock, this is just to show you that Mike Lukovich, who is a world-renowned cartoonist, didn't just pick on Newt. He picked on me for other reasons. I used to be that large, but I'm a lot smaller now. I'm more like the gorilla in this picture. But we believe that the environment is always is going to be in stalemate until we start talking to each other in civil ways. It can't be right versus left. It can't be red versus blue. Newt likes to use the phrase red, white, and blue. But the truth is, it is a nonpartisan, bipartisan, and I say sometimes, I like to say, multi-partisan process. And we have to find common ground on the political side. We have to find a way into this environment to solve the real problems that exist. We won't do it. One party won't do it with the other party trying to stop them. We've got to work together. So the whole book, if you read it carefully, is an appeal at civil dialogue, consensus, and participatory politics that is positive and optimistic. The media are reflecting this environmental century almost everywhere you turn. You see articles about it, you know, conservation is hot. Well, in many ways it is. Arnold Schwarzenegger, he's there. Now, he's had an interesting experience in the environment because as a Republican governor working with a Democratic assembly, he's had to forge bipartisan solutions. California is out front on many things. One of the ways that California, my home state, is ahead of Florida, but maybe not for long, is in the propagation of solar power. When I got here, I kept scratching my head, where's the solar power? There's a lot of sun in Florida, seems to me. Maybe not as much as New Mexico or Arizona, but there's a lot of sun here. And now we see that indeed there is an opportunity for solar because Governor Crist has taken that on. And Florida Power and Light, who is a marketing partner of the zoo, they are involved in solar power, but they're very, very involved in wind power. As we've written about it in the book, they are the largest holder of wind farms in the United States. But they're not in Florida. The wind farms are in Oklahoma, Kansas. They're all around. And I can remember when I was living in Northern California when they put in the first windmills along the highway from Stockton, Davis area into Oakland, San Francisco. And these things are huge now. If you've taken a look at the ones that are in the North Sea, the ones that are around Denmark, the ones that are in surrounding Netherlands, they're huge. And the technology is very much advanced. But like every technology, there are little problems. The Audubon Society is worried because these windmills can hurt birds. So you have to be careful where you put them. You have to build in little tricks of the trade so you can protect the birds that might go by. As always, there's a downside, and you have to figure your way out of it. What we advocate in the book with our optimism, which is important, is that don't give up on these new technologies just because there's a little quirk or a problem here. Let's figure out a way to get there. We tend to destroy our own solutions too fast. We need to work these things out. Ethanol is one of those things. You know, you read about ethanol being a solution, the very next day somebody writes and says, well, ethanol, if you do too much ethanol, you destroy the environment. It takes too much energy to produce ethanol. There's all kinds of downsides to it. We just got to get those smart people in a room to work these things out. Because the alternatives are a whole lot worse. You're going to see a lot of debate and dialogue on nuclear power. Because there are countries in the world, France, for example, that are utilizing nuclear power and they're eliminating their greenhouse gas emissions. Now, if that's really, really important, then you got to look at nuclear. And the downside of nuclear, we know what that is. We got to work on any of these solutions to try to find a win-win. That's going to be the difficult part, but you got to have the conversation if you really want to fix it. Now, there are a lot of magazines, as I say, that have taken on this issue. Polls have shown over and over again that the public supports the environment. It is a very important issue, and people believe it's important, but when you put the environment against something like the war in Iraq or the economy, the environment is never the top priority. But it is now becoming an issue that is a very, very high in the background, and it will have it will resonate when you deal with issues like the economy. Now, when Newt and I began to talk about a book, it really came down to deciding that there had to be an alternative pathway because conservatives just weren't signing up. And my view on this is without two parties equally committed, we're never going to get there where we need to go. So we had the high hopes that we could put this nonpartisan book together, a book that was positive, was optimistic, hopeful, was not a doomsday book about the environment, but one that says, yes, if we do the right things, we can do it. And that's where Contract with the Earth came in. And it was based in part on my belief and Newt's belief that companies were already there on the environment. They were already out there doing things, FPL being among them. Now, some of you who've lived in Florida longer than me probably have a beef or two with FPL. I understand that. But, you know, there's some good things too. But we want all these companies to sprint toward green technologies, and we have to encourage them. So I'm happy with a lot of what's being done. There are articles all the time about people, individual entrepreneurs and business people that choose to make their company green, to create a green plant, do things differently because they just want to do it right. And there are tremendous innovations that are coming forward. Now, we also have looked at the automobile situation. In the book, we really extol the virtues of hybrid cars. My friend Glenn Eakey just bought a hybrid Toyota. And you like it, right, Glenn?
I love it.
He loves it. Hybrids are out there. Toyota's got some of the best. And we had a meeting with Earl Stewart not long ago, and he told us that he's the biggest seller of hybrid vehicles anywhere. He's so sold out of them most of the time. So this is a great product. But around the corner, folks, is coming hydrogen. And looking at the hydrogen, I believe that if we could sprint to hydrogen, we would be a whole lot better when it comes to emissions than anything we're doing right now. But we can't say it's going to take 50 years. We've got to sprint to it as if we were trying to get to the moon. So we're not the only ones talking about sprinting to green technologies, but the automobile makers are out there already doing great things. We have to find a way to enter that marketplace in such a way that it begins to dominate, and it won't be easy because of the distribution systems and other things that have to be fixed in order to make this happen in a big way. We also know that, and it seems to be true, that the emission standards coming out of Kyoto and other places are going to be very, very tough to hit. Europe has struggled with the quotas that they agreed to. Canada can't do it. And we know that China and India won't do it. The USA is doing it voluntarily, but having the same trouble that Europe's doing. So can we reach these aggressive goals? Probably not. Without a revolutionary commitment to technology change, transformative technologies. And I believe America has the ability to do this, and Newt is leading the way in this discussion. Now, recently, we had a chance to write an article based on our book that was published just about a month ago in a journal of the National Academy of Sciences. This is a journal called Issues in Science and Technology. And we're promoting the idea of this inclusive environment, the movement that will bring us closer to fixing the Earth, or renewing the Earth, as Newt likes to say. And that dialogue is ongoing now in major journals, major magazines. We're getting a lot of ink. The book itself has been reviewed well. There are a few bad reviews. There always are. Most of the reviews have been very good. I find it interesting, though, some of the really bad ones that I've read, and I've read them all. It's painful to read bad reviews. But one of the things that makes it better for me is that most of the ones that hate the book don't hate the book because they haven't read the book. They just hate Newt. So they write an article about how much they hate Newt, so I always say, well, that's not me. I mean, so, but, you know, it is a book that draws some heat. But mostly we feel very, very good about the reception we've received, and to have the prestigious National Academy of Sciences ask us to write this piece, we were very honored to be able to do that. You may want to pick this up if you're looking for a copy of it. I'll be glad to send one to you. There's so much going on out there. It was a really good article about growing fuel, the ethanol debate, in National Geographic magazine. And it is a highly charged and a complex field of inquiry. There are a lot of issues, but American technology is leading the way, and there's a lot we can do. You have to remember, though, there are countries that have already made this commitment. Brazil is already powered up on ethanol. Sugar-based ethanol. And they're doing really well down there. So we can learn from some of these developing countries that made the decision a while back. We talk a lot, by the way, in the book, about places that are doing it right. And we see evidence of public-private partnerships, of nations that are building great enterprise around new technologies. And we give a lot of credit to some of the conservation organizations like Conservation International and Nature Conservancy, because they have a history of bringing industrial giants like Walmart, for example, to the table in countries like Costa Rica to build conservation programs because they're the right thing to do. So I applaud their leadership. As you read this book, you will see the number one issue for us is leadership. We think without presidential leadership in this country, without a priority expressed by a strong leader, the environment is not going to go in the direction we need it to go. So this is an important election. Look for a leader who will make this commitment. And there will be some arguments and debates about this, I can assure you, as this political season unfolds. Newt is going to be a gadfly. He will be out there advocating his solutions, and I'm really glad he's chosen to be very visible about this. Some of us wish he had chosen to be a candidate, but he will certainly advocate on the environment, and that'll be a good thing. Now, discuss briefly how complex the environment is, I wanted to show you this slide to remind you we had a hurricane at the zoo. It happened all over this area, but it really made it tough on our carousel, all these smashed up things. So I thought this was a great metaphor for what happened to us. But what it reminded me of is this, that a lot of global warming theorists predicted worse and worse hurricanes, and they were just going to get worse and worse. And I think the last 2 years we were supposed to have about 17 hurricanes. Well, knock on wood, this has not happened here. And it may not happen. But all that tells me is that predicting the environment, and particularly climate, is an extremely difficult process. And we do not have all the information we need to make really good predictions. But there is clearly plenty of evidence to suggest that we've got serious problems with global warming, global climate change. And Newt acknowledges that, and acknowledges that if we're smart, we will study this problem, we will do what we can to mitigate, but we will also begin to consider the possibility that we may have to adapt, that some things may be unchangeable. And that's when you have to get honest about what are you going to have to do about it to make sure it doesn't do too much damage. The dialogue we have around the world with developing countries that are maybe at greater risk than we are is going to take utmost diplomacy. So you can see why I think that presidential leadership is going to be so critical as we deal with whatever may come our way in this global environment. But surely the technology of America is going to be a major factor. And naturally, being a zoo guy, what I want to see happen is we pay special attention to what's happening to these vulnerable animal populations, polar bears and other creatures that appear to be at greater risk because of different effects of warming. Now, I want to say, too, that one of the most fun things to write about in the book was sea turtle conservation. I came to know sea turtles when I moved down here. I didn't know a thing about them until I went over to the Turtle Center in Juneau Beach and got to know some turtles. And I now think that they're among the world's most special creatures. We're going to be supporting some turtle research in the next 12 months. And I can assure you the Palm Beach Zoo is very concerned about turtle populations. Here, turtles are special because, as you know, we protect the beaches, try to make it easier for those turtles to lay their eggs. And around the world, there's a lot of effective turtle conservation going on. If you're ever up at Orlando at the Disney park, they've got a wonderful show. Crush the Turtle is probably the most engaging spokes critter for conservation I've ever seen. You should take your kids there to see that because it's really very inspiring. Now, down the road, one of the things we're doing, and I'm going to stop here in a moment so we can get some questions. We're building something pretty special. Dan and Kathy Comerford are in the audience. They're board members of mine, and they know how special this project is. We'll be opening a major facility at the end of this year, the Melvin and Claire Levin Animal Care Complex. And within that is the Zeitlin Animal Hospital and a Center for Conservation Medicine. Conservation medicine is a new field. You can read about it in that October issue of National Geographic that talks about corn. It's also a great article about conservation medicine. The context is one medicine, which says that veterinarians, both those that work with wild and captive populations, doctors, epidemiologists, biologists, field biologists, microbiologists, all of these people working together at the same table are needed to solve the potential pandemics that are headed our way. It was a Bronx Zoo pathologist, a veterinarian, who discovered West Nile. Because in our zoos, we monitor and measure everything that dies. If a rat dies or a blackbird dies, we pick it up and we test it. Lo and behold, they found West Nile, the first example of it in the United States. Zoos are monitoring their animals, working with CDC to understand better captive and wild populations and what this means for viruses that jump from animals to humans. Hantavirus in the West, Ebola, even AIDS was a simian virus that jumped. So we are concerned about bird flu and all these things. So we need to look out to the Caribbean, to coastal Florida, into South and Central America and beyond to partner with scientists and technicians, people that are concerned about the Earth, to understand better how these disease systems are working to plague humankind and animalkind. So it is now one medicine. And Palm Beach Zoo is going to be on the map in this area, out of this beautiful facility, which will be state of the art. Now, as I said, I guess I'm an environmental writer now. Penguin has bought the rights to our book in paperback. I thought it was kind of fun because just today I got the cover that Penguin is going to put on this book. It's kind of a cute little cover. But notice that my name is getting smaller. This is Newt's book, you know, this is the way it is. But I did tell the editor, I said, this is because my wife said this. She said, well, maybe they could change the leaf to a maple leaf, and then it would be, you know, it would make your name bigger. You know, I don't know if that's going to happen. But for better or for worse, we're gonna work on this. I'm writing a new chapter for this book. And Newt and I have signed a contract with Johns Hopkins to do an edited book, which will have a deeper detail about how to implement the contract and how to renew the earth. We're looking for some expert writers to work on this book with us, and that'll be a lot of fun to do. So I think we're a writing team now that will go on, you know, as far as we can take it. I mentioned at the beginning that there were a lot of things we could do, and I didn't want to go any further on this without introducing our cat, Ducky, because this is an example of things you can do. And I'm proud of this, because we decided Ducky was going to be an indoor cat. Now, the main reason Ducky's an indoor cat is to protect her. But I'm amazed at how much fun she has living indoors. She chases lizards all the time. They're on the outside, of course. She can't get those lizards. But the number of animals that are saved by cats who don't live outside is astounding. I have a friend, Bill Conway, general director of the Bronx Zoo for years and years. He's militant on this issue. I'm so proud when I see him to say, Ducky is an indoor cat. How many birds I've saved with this process. So there are little things that we can do in our homes, in our backyard habitats, little things we can do in our communities, in our workplace, in our lives. But those little things add up. And those little things are inspiring to others. Now, I hope you enjoyed coming here to hear a little bit about my experience writing this book. I hope you will have some questions for me that I can answer. And I hope you'll come down to the zoo to see us. We do have a lovely zoo, a very conservation-minded zoo. We have a wonderful organization called the Big Cat Club. And I'd like at least a few of you to join the Big Cat Club tonight. This is our conservation club that is going to really support in a big way the programs we have evolving at the zoo. So you come down and see us, and come see me. I will enjoy talking to you. Thank you so much for coming tonight. Thank you.